Hi, welcome to the show, Excellence in All Things. I'm your host, Barbara Golar. I'm so excited. This is our third series in interviewing our candidates for Monrovia Unified School District. And who I have in studio today is, oh my goodness, Jennifer, there's three names.
Jennifer Baird Anderson.
You know, it was there and then I lost it. Anyway, without any further, I apologize.
No worries. You know what? Men usually hear Jennifer Aniston, not Jennifer Anderson.
Yeah. Oh, that makes sense. That's
funny. A little disappointing when they realize it's not Jennifer Aniston.
Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce to you Jennifer Baird Anderson.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you for having me.
Oh, you're so welcome. And it's an honor to be able to actually, this is my second time. I think it was about 2 years ago that I had the opportunity to interview the candidates before. Mm-hmm. And so this was, it was a real honor. And I really do feel very honored to be able to do this again.
Thank
also,
you.
One other thing I want to do before I start the question is that I also want to thank all of you out there that send in your questions to ask these candidates, because I wouldn't be able to do this if it wasn't for you out there. So I want to thank you. So anyway, okay. So what I want to do is just start off with these questions, and then you know you can always interject what your platform is and things like that. Does that make sense?
It does.
Okay. So there are 12 questions, but in those 12 questions, there are also some bullet points in there as
okay.
well. Okay?
All right.
So the first question is, what motivated you to want to become a school board member?
So my passion is education, and I have four children. And I've been in Monrovia, this is our 16th year. And in those years, I have dedicated my time to supporting and making Monrovia schools the best possible. And with our current situation, I believe that I have some very unique skills that I can bring. And I'm very connected to the community and the teachers, and I'm very involved with PTA. And I know the inner workings of school, the school day in Monrovia. I also used to be a teacher, and I was actually hired at PCC to teach mathematics in a computer and lecture-based model. So we would go back and forth. So I'm very familiar with, we called it computer-based learning, but there was a teacher portion and a computer portion. And so combined with all of those things, I really feel it's a calling. I feel it's my duty to step up and offer to serve, because I feel like I have something I can give back.
I thank you. And the next part of that question is, as a new or incumbent, what do you think you have to offer to the board in this new reality that we are now living with the distant learning?
Right. So I sort of just spoke to that. My background is in education as well and mathematics. I've been an integral part of the planning committees for the last 5 months on how to get the kids back in school and make sure that they're being educated. But by and large, the biggest piece is I'm a parent of four kids. Three of them are still in Monrovia schools. And I know how things are working. I know when things aren't working, and I know how to work together with other people to solve our problems and to think creatively so that we can, because we're going to need everybody's problem solving skills here. Those are my biggest strengths, I think, right now during COVID.
Okay, thank you. the next question is, what kind of relationship should a school board member have with the community, with its parents and families?
I would hope a very strong one. That's one of the biggest messages that I have, is that we need to embrace everybody. We need to make sure that as parents are now a key component of their child's education.
Absolutely.
They have got to be a part of the planning, a part of the strategy, a part of the solution, a part of the conversation. And that takes from school board down to administrator, to parents, to teachers, to kids, to all of the support staff in our on our campuses and our community. We have strong ties with the city of Monrovia as well. We need our whole community to come together to work for the education of our kids. And the school board is just one component. So in a word, strong.
Yeah, good, thank you. Mm-hmm. Next question is, what attributes are essential for a successful school board member?
The first thing I would say is the ability to listen and to seek knowledge and information. One of the things I've learned, I've been a PTA leader for a number of years, and it's easy when you're in the hot seat to think, I'm just gonna make a decision. And what I've found works better for me is to sit down and listen to everybody. And because you'll hear somebody's argument for a program, let's mm-hmm. say, and you think, wow, that's fantastic, I love it. And then somebody else says, yes, but that's going to cause these ripple effects. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be a problem for somebody else. Ooh, good point. I didn't think of that. All right, and somebody says, yes, but how about we address it this way? And then that fixes that problem, and we can still have this program. So I really think that listening to all the stakeholders, I think parents, teachers, administrators, and kids, anybody who has a stake in the game, sit down and listen, and then make the decision based on the good, the greatest good for our community of learners. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Next question is, this always makes me chuckle.
Okay.
Students have complained that the food at the high school tastes like prison food. Can vendors be changed? And if not, why?
Well, first I would say, I hope they don't know that firsthand. How do they know that? I don't know. I have limited experience tasting the high school food. Vendors can always be changed. Absolutely. If the food is not tasty or being enjoyed by our students, let's look into finding a way that they're actually going to eat the food that they're offered. There's no point in having food if no one's eating it. Yeah. So absolutely, that's easy enough. Yeah.
Next question is, what are your thoughts about Black Lives Matter?
Black Lives Matter. That's the bottom line, Black Lives Matter. I think in conjunction with COVID, that might be one of the blessings in this situation. All of the trauma and destruction that we've had in our society with COVID has made us very raw, and I think it's finally gotten everybody's attention. And just last night, one more attack on Jacob Blake, right? Which is heartbreaking. Really, Black Lives Matter. That's my point, Black Lives Matter.
Let's see, this is a two. Okay. Next question is, when is the school board going to name a building by Mimi Mincy? She was, I don't know if you know who Mimi Mincy is.
I do not.
Okay. All right, then. I don't know what to say after
that. I'm not sure I can answer that.
She is, to my knowledge, I believe she was the first Black school board member.
Oh, fantastic.
And so she did a lot of things for the school. I went to high school with her daughter.
Aww.
And she also did lots of community work and stuff within the city.
Gotcha. Okay.
She did.
All right. Yeah. Obviously I don't know the answer
right.
to that.
Yes.
But what I would say is, I don't know how buildings are named for people, but I would like to learn more about her.
Okay.
Mimi Mincy. Okay.
Yes. Many of the candidates seem to focus on various programs for good students, such as those in robotics or math and science program, but don't advocate for students who won't be going to college or those with learning challenges. How would you as a candidate promote all students in our school, not just those going to our college bound?
I taught at PCC for a number of years before I had children. And I understand that's a college, but that's sort of a halfway between university and a career path or a trade. I wish we could get back to a world where college was not the only path, and I think we're working our way there. I think that is critical. I think that is a really, really important distinction. My son is in college, went to PCC for 2 years and just transferred to Cal Poly Pomona to study computer science. One of his good friends in high school decided he wanted to be a welder. And I think that's fabulous because he wants to make his own furniture. And if that's what makes him happy, we need to find ways to empower him. Now, our high school has a lot of college to career pathways. I would like to increase that. I think that what we need to do is offer kids what makes them happy and how to teach them to be successful in that. It doesn't have to be Harvard. It doesn't have to be anything. It has to be, in fact, here's an example. One of our first robotics students was also a MASA student. And I'm heavily involved in robotics and mass. I'm a big believer in them, but I'm also a big believer in the trade aspect. She didn't go to college. She started her own company instead and did quite well for herself and didn't need to go to college because she had learned skills to be able to do that. So the real trick isn't where you go. It's let's find a way to empower our kids to find what makes them happy, where they want to reach out, and let's figure out a way to empower them to do that.
Well, I know I was born and raised here, so I went through the schools here.
Yeah.
Clifton, there used to be wood shop.
I know.
At the high school, I think there was the what do you call it? The mechanics.
Auto shop,
yeah.
Yeah, there's auto shop there now also.
Oh, okay, yeah, see it.
In fact, the auto shop teacher is also one of the robotics mentors.
Yeah, so, yeah. And you know, also in this, I don't know, like, see, at Clifton, you had to take home economics. Everybody had
they
to
go through
that.
You don't even have it now.
You know, and it, so that's really some basic skills.
It is, and you know, I've talked about this recently with Susan Hirsch, who's the director of the Wellness Center at the high school.
Yeah.
And she and I had a conversation when COVID shut down, and the first thing my daughter said was, wow, they shouldn't have gotten rid of all those cooking and sewing classes because people need to make bread and sew their masks. And I talked to Susan and I said, this is something we're really missing. And this makes me sad because I cook and sew and I do lots of crafty things. And so she and I are working on trying to find a way to get that, even as a club, to have it as an offering through the Wellness Center. So kids can come in. There was an article a few years ago about kids that were sort of marginalized and sent to the continuation high school that had, you know, the kids that just were sort of written off. And somebody came in and started a knitting club. And it had such a huge success because it taught them patience. It taught them, right? It taught them how to stay calm, hand, eye, the tactile.
This is very soothing.
Well, I find it very soothing. And that's something else. Let's teach our kids to knit. Come on by. In fact, I did that a few years ago with just summer hobbies for the kids in the community. Mm-hmm. These are really, really critical aspects.
Yeah.
And I talked about the board meeting last night, about offering electives during summer school. That's a great idea. I would love to see our kids more involved with electives.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I'm going to tell you this, the next few questions, the next three questions have to do with special education.
Okay.
And what I did, because the way they were coming in, I go, oh no, I want to frame this so that we're not jumping all over the place. So things that are close to the same topic there together.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, approximately 10 to 15% of students in the district have IEPs. In order to understand the IEP process and fully represent this group of students, do you think that school board members should attend at least one IEP? How would you improve? I'm going to read the whole thing,
okay.
And then, because there's like four in
and
here.
And then we'll go back.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Yes. How would you improve the reading scores for special education? Do you think Monrovia Unified School District should adopt a testing program for dyslexia in kindergarten? If the school district adopts a special education committee, what percentage of special ed parents and should parents be included as part of that committee? So the first part of that is, do you think that, school board members should attend at least one IEP?
So that sounds like a good idea. I'd be happy to do that. I also know that there may be some privacy laws involved.
Yeah, yeah.
So if I was invited to one, I would absolutely attend. In fact, I would attend any IEP that I was invited to. I think that's important.
Okay. So then next is, how would you improve the reading scores for special education?
So the way I understand it, there's not going to be a one size fits all for any child,
mm-hmm.
and certainly not for special education as well. I do know we've had a lot of success this summer with the summer reading programs that they were phenomenal. If you listen to the board meeting last night, Dr. Kaiser reported on them, and the kids grew like 1 to 2 years. Instead of a couple of months, and they were in for, I think, 4 weeks. So I would assume that that's a perfect application. And if they don't directly work with the needs of any particular child, I'm sure there are adaptations, but I would look into programs like that, which clearly have data-driven results,
mm-hmm.
And then the children really enjoyed.
Yeah. Okay, the next part of that is, do you think the school board should adopt a testing program for dyslexia in kindergarten?
That's a pretty specific question, and since I don't have the expertise on what the best practices are or what the legal ramifications are, I would say that that's a good question to pose to our special ed department. I know that testing is available if asked. And hopefully if a teacher looks at a child and says, I think there might be a reason to test you, that happens as well. But to just make a blanket statement that it needs to be done, I would need to look into that more to find out what other, what's already being done,
mm-hmm.
and why do we need to do that instead of just if the parent says, I think my child may have dyslexia, or the teacher says, I think maybe this child has dyslexia.
The next question, and this is the last one of that particular question.
Okay.
If the school district adopts a special education committee, what percentage of parents, and if parents should be a part of that committee?
So I believe they already have a special ed committee. It may just be for the subcommittee to reopen the schools, because I know that there are a number of task forces to open the, you know, to deal with the schedule and planning. But let's say there's not. In my opinion, what percentage? So you need to really look at all the stakeholders and say, okay, so we need administrators and we need teachers, and there may be specialists in there, and parents are a given. You may or may not want children, depending on what kind of a forum it is. So take all the subgroups and divide them up, and everybody gets an equal portion. Sit down and we want to hear from as many people as possible.
Okay, thank you. Next question. Does closing the achievement gap include reading?
Absolutely.
Do you believe that special education has the right to learn how to read in a way that works best, that works, excuse me, that I put the word best in there?
Okay. So can you start it from the beginning?
Yes, I am. Do you believe that special education students, have the right to learn how to read in a way that works for them?
Yes, absolutely. I would go further and say all children should have the right to learn to read or learn math or science or whatever it is in a way that works for them. That's one of the benefits of having diversity in our classrooms is that people teach and learn in different ways.
Yes. Oh, okay. My head went someplace else with a story, so I'll do that app.
Okay.
Off camera.
Gotcha. All right. I look forward to listening.
Okay. Please comment on the use of taxpayers' dollars intended for education being used to pay for for-profit private law firms to fight students with disability.
So I would need to look into the details of that because I don't know what funds are being used for private law firms to fight students with disabilities.
Yes.
So you mean
I'm going to read it again. Please comment on the use of taxpayers' dollars intended for education being used to pay for for-profit private law firms to fight students with disabilities. I think, in other words, they're talking about a student with disabilities. There's a lawsuit going on, so the school district is using for-profit private law firms.
So
I think that's how I'm reading this.
Let me just say this.
Okay.
So everyone has a right to an education. That sounds like maybe there's a specific case or two that they're referring to, of which I'm not aware. But everybody has a right to a free and public education. I guess it sounds like not everybody's in agreement on how to do that. And that's where that comes in. Now, how do I feel about funds being? I would need to know more about where the funds are coming from. They might be restricted for only that kind of use. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I would have to look into that to give you a solid answer.
Yeah. Okay. What is your plan to eliminate the dyslexia prison pipeline?
Okay, so I'm guessing what they're referring to is the third grade literacy rates. And third grade literacy is often tied to the count of prison beds, like 20 years, 30 years down the line. And I know this because I've been on the LCAP, the old LCAP, not the new LCAP.
Oh, okay.
The LCAP since the beginning, since LCAP started. And one of the things that, I don't remember which state, I want to say Georgia, would actually tally what the literacy rate was of their third graders, mm-hmm. and then project how many prison beds they needed based upon that, which is horrifying. So given that information, that's one of the things that we adopted and made a huge push for. Yeah, it's horrifying, isn't it?
Wow.
Way to set up our kids. Yeah, you can't read, you're probably going to jail. Right? That's awful. So what we've done here in Monrovia is said, that's not okay. We need to make sure our kids meet that benchmark in third grade, and that will give them the skills and the empowerment and the opportunity to make what they want of their lives and not just throw them aside. So our LCAP has in its top three, one of them is third grade literacy. Mm-hmm. Now, it doesn't speak specifically to dyslexia, it's literacy across the board. Mm-hmm. I was actually sad because my youngest two, who are in 10th grade now, were in third grade at the time this conversation came about. So third grade literacy push didn't start until the next year. So they missed it. It was amazing the difference within that year, how much the Lexile, which is like the index for reading,
right.
how much the students in third grade gained. And so we've rolled it, that same program back to second grade and on down as well. So now I've kind of forgotten exactly what the question was, but hopefully it was just speak to it. Third grade literacy is important. Yeah. It's one of the most important things we focus on in LCAP. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. What will you do to reduce litigations from special education families and improve special education graduation rate, literacy rates, and matriculation to higher education?
So this actually is really what I think our district needs in general, and it's not just for special education. It's the communication piece. If you sit down and talk to each other, you learn something from somebody else. And if you learn something from somebody else, you have more empathy, more compassion, and you're willing to work together. If you can see something from someone else's perspective, you are much more likely to find a solution that works for both of you. We need this for every student, special ed included. That means school board, that means administrators, teachers, parents, students, community leaders. We all need to come together. This problem is bigger than, we have lots of problems bigger than any one of us. And yeah. I would never want to presume that I had all the answers or that somebody didn't have something to offer. Mm-hmm. So in a word, just sit down and listen. Let's come together.
Okay. Thank you. This is now about preventative. Preventative maintenance for all campuses.
Okay.
Who is responsible for the upkeep and maintenance of the school grounds, and who is the person accountable to, and would that be the principal of each school?
So I would say that there's sort of a more complicated answer, and ultimately it's the school board to approve certain decisions. Like I don't know if we're talking about trimming the grass every week or if we're talking about installing a new field on the football field, but so there are lots of people that have a piece there. Obviously the administrators on site have an investment and a responsibility. We have a maintenance team in MUSD, and obviously they're invested and have responsibility. So does the school board. There are a lot of people. I'm going to bring it back once again to communication. We all need to be working on the same page here, right? So I don't know that I would ever want to point a finger at any one person and say, this was you. That seems like a group effort, and it's important. It's not always kept up as much as we want it to be. And in fact, I'm on the facilities advisory committee, which has been delayed because right now the biggest problem we have is making sure our kids are educated. Right. Yeah. So that's been put on hold for a little bit, but it's important.
Now this is this is the last question.
Okay.
Would you support a change of the curriculum in teaching history and social studies to represent the truth about our history, the truth about slavery, the truth about Columbus, Thanksgiving, the Civil War, Jim Crow, and civil rights?
Yes, absolutely. History is really important to me, although I was a math teacher. One of my hobbies is genealogy and doing family research. Mm-hmm. And I found that I've not just done my family trees, but I've done friends and other people. And you know, sometimes you read an article and you go down a rabbit hole and you just want to learn more about that person.
Yes.
And it is amazing what is yeah. out there that you that we just don't know, that certainly wasn't taught to me when I was in school. We're all going to benefit more by understanding our shared history together.
Yeah.
We'll have more compassion. We'll have a greater sense of respect for the difficulties that different groups have had. And there's nothing but good that can come from learning more about each other and our history. And we have to be honest about that.
Well, you know, this just popped in my head. You know, I'm not sure the, you know, I'm just the messenger.
Gotcha. Okay.
You know, but as I, you know, this is my third time like reading this. And so I'm imagining that this person is coming from the position of it's not just, it really is our history. Because
yes, it is.
If we don't know the truth.
Do you think we're talking about SB 331? Is that what they're referring to?
I have no idea.
Okay. So,
I have no idea.
Yeah, I think the bottom line here is we need to be honest about what
yes,
happened.
Yes, yes,
right.
Yeah, that's the bottom line.
Let's just go with that.
Yeah,
honesty is always a good option, and it might be challenging. It might be hard. It
yeah.
might be uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean it's not worthwhile.
Yeah, because we all lose. You understand that?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, we all lose.
And you know what else we lose? It, not just the compassion and the understanding. We lose the knowledge of what came before
yeah.
and what not to do again.
Yeah.
How in the world do we help prevent ourselves from making mistakes if yeah. we don't have that collective memory?
Yeah. Yeah.
We don't.
Yeah.
And I don't want to go back, do you?
No,
thank you. We have plenty ahead of us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So on that note, this is the, you know, like that was the last question.
Alrighty.
So now you have the opportunity to actually share your platform and also share, you know, how people can be able to donate or reach out to you.
Okay.
So you can share your contact information.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Barbara.
Oh, this was a pleasure.
It was really delightful. Yeah.
And remind me to tell you something after.
I
off
will.
Camera.
I okay. will.
All right.
All right. Sounds great. And once again, thanks for the opportunity.
You're welcome.
So I am running for school board, not because I have a desire for more work and harder work, but because I believe in our kids. And for the last 15 years, I have dedicated my time to working to make our schools better. And I believe that now is the time when parents are needed more than ever as we try to teach our children from home and engage with our teachers remotely. Parents are a key component. We need to ensure that the parents are a part of that voice. And I'm a proud parent of four, three of whom are still in MUSD. I can see the day-to-day workings of what's going on, where we run into some trouble, where things already with the school year, I've been in contact with administrators and said, you know what, we need to make sure that this message is getting out to families. It's really important that we have that on the ground feedback. On top of that, I have spent this last several years building relationships with our teachers and our school board, as well as other volunteers and parents in the community. And what I've learned from all of them is we all have something important to bring to the table. And by coming together and sharing with one another instead of just doing our little piece, we learn much more about our community and we do much better service to our children. So I would appreciate your vote. You may learn more about me at Jennifer Baird Anderson. Oop, I'm sorry, that's my full name. Jennifer Anderson, JenniferAnderson, the number 4, MUSD.com. Jennifer Anderson, the number 4, MUSD.com. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you once again
okay.
for coming and sharing. So I hope you listened, took notes, and continue to practice safe distancing, and go out. Well, what you can do is just be kind and be a blessing to someone. And I also again want to want to thank the community for the questions that you have for the candidates. So we'll see you again. This is the third series. So we have third.
Two more.
Okay. So so keep watching, and so you'll see all five candidates in this series. So take care and be a blessing.